Y acá se cumple eso. Con ello nosotros alcanzamos crecimientos volumétricos de hasta 400 a 420 metros cúbicos de madera por hectárea. El segundo factor importante, además del clima, es el manejo silvicultural y el manejo del suelo. La sustentabilidad para nosotros significa trabajar en lo ambiental y en lo social, en lo ambiental, disminuyendo los impactos que podamos generar con las plantaciones, y fundamentalmente nosotros estamos seguros de que tenemos impactos positivos, especialmente en la captura de carbono, en lo que nosotros contribuiremos al cambio climático.
If we are serious about climate change, we should plant trees, a lot of trees, because trees are one of the best way to capture CO2 from the atmosphere. And the faster the trees grow, the more carbon they capture from the atmosphere. And that's why we like eucalyptus in Paraguay so much, because the trees grow extremely fast here. On average, we are capturing between 150 to 200 tons of CO2 per hectare. On top of that, we are also harvesting the trees and replanting them, thus allowing for using the wood to create sustainable products to substitute oil-based product and also sequester the carbon inside the products, like in furniture or construction material.
So hello everyone. Apologies for the slight glitch in the beginning, but I'm sure we will cover everything you missed from the audio during the session, so no problem there. I guess the biggest part we wanted to show that video was really for the picture. So I have the pleasure to introduce here Martin Forsen, who's the chairman of Silvipar, the company that is a private Swedish company with a very impressive expertise in both industrial and forestry management, and is the company that has been developing the asset that you just saw for the last 10 years. And myself, I'm a co-founder and managing partner of Astarte. It was the little letters, the small letters under the logo. Astarte, for those who don't know us, we are an asset manager focused exclusively in real assets. We're based in London, but with fairly global presence. And three things, the easiest way to remember us, three things about us is we like to invest in, to follow macro trends and invest in areas that have long-term fundamental need for capital investment because of the long-term macro trends playing out. We are extremely sensitive about sustainability, and our investment approach is to always find who we think is best in class from an operating expertise and invest together. So the purpose now turning into the discussion today is, since the beginning of the year, we have joined Silvipar as an investor, co-sponsor, co-manager of the project in order for together to bring the project to its institutional scale, really, which we target about 55,000 hectares, $250 million US dollar investment, serving both commercial with significant returns. I can say that we are really targeting very high teens at least, and significant impact. Just on the carbon credit side, as you heard from the video, that brings us as an estimated sequestration of about 14 million tons at the project size. And I guess what we wanted to share with you through that process is that for the last 5 months, we have been in the market fundraising, sharing our experience with additional LPs, a pretty wide range of LPs, which include both real asset investors, corporate, impact, climate change investors. And we wanted to bring back the insights really from that process, all the key questions that the LPs ask, the ones that maybe they should be asking, and generally what we feel are the key things for LPs to know, investing into forestry from a sustainability and climate change perspective. So to that, turning it initially to Martin. So Martin, the floor is yours. Tell us, why Paraguay? I know that's also a bit the piece we missed from the video. So why really go to Paraguay? And you are muted, Martin.
Second time muted today. This is, yeah, a bad start. Sorry about that. Now, we really believe that Paraguay is the best country in the world for a forest investment. And we've known this for quite a while, because the history actually goes back all the way back to 99, when we used to have a biorefinery up in northern Sweden. And I would like to mention this because we're using wood raw material to producing different sustainable products. Just as like some examples of what we were producing up there was, we were Northern Europe's largest producer of biogas. We were producing something called lignosulfonate that was used in the cement industry to make the cement stronger. We were producing ethanol for cars, substituting fossil-based fuels. And we're also producing something called dissolving cellulose that was used in textiles, replacing nylon and cotton, that most of you, I'm sure, knows that it's fairly bad for the environment and producing cotton. And we believe that the forest industry is something that's really needed for the future, the green future, sustainable economy. And we showed with this mill that you can actually do it and very economic viable. We were for a while the most profitable mill in Sweden. And we started to think that if you can do it in a country where the trees take 100 years to grow, what if you can do it in a country where it takes 7 years to grow? And where you also would have a greater social impact, where it's needed more an economic development. So we did an analysis. We looked at over 100 different countries. We did an in-depth analysis of 12, where we visited them and did a thorough analysis. And we found Paraguay. And we believe that Paraguay is the best country on earth to build a forest industry, but there were no plantations there at that time. So, and the reason why Paraguay is great is that it has a very high biological growth rates. I mean, I remember when I went to forestry school and they said that someday maybe we will reach a growth rate of 50 cubic meters per hectare in a year. And we have already passed that in our plantations now in Paraguay. They also
measured three times. Just for anyone wondering out there, right?
Yes. And we also see that the logistics, even though, I mean, Paraguay is landlocked, but you still have excellent logistics through the Paraná River. So it's one of the world's third largest barge systems. You have easy access to markets and customers for your product. So we then started to establish plantations in 2013 in Paraguay.
And I guess then I'm pretty sure already some people are frowning or thinking, we are talking about eucalyptus plantations, right? Mm. So let's go straight to the question of why eucalyptus. Is the question that either some people ask straight away or should, or, you know, avoid asking, so.
Yes. I mean, we believe that eucalyptus is the world's best tree. I mean, it's a very efficient tree. It uses very little water per biomass produced. And since it grows so extremely fast, the benefits from the plantations are coming quicker. I mean, both the social benefits, I mean, you have, again, comparing if you would plant a tree in Sweden where it takes 50 to 100 years before you can harvest, it takes 50 to 100 years before you get the benefits. Here you will get them in 6 to 7 years. And also, I mean, if we are serious about climate change, you need to have fast growing trees, because the faster the tree grows, the quicker the impact and the more carbon is sequestered. And then, as I mentioned in the video, if you're also able to turn them into sustainable wood products, then you're also able to sequester the carbon in the products, but also substitute oil-based products. And that is why we are using what we call a multi-purpose eucalyptus, where the trees can be used from anything from solid wood all the way up to bioenergy, where you take the most valuable part of the tree and turn it into solid wood products. The less valuable part of the tree, you make it into either pulp or to bioenergy.
I guess it's worth mentioning, because the straight other point about that is biodiversity, right? Right. Really, that's really where usually commercial plantations are criticized, and eucalyptus perhaps. So would you like to touch on that as well? How sustainable is really, you know, this specific asset and plantation from all other aspects, including biodiversity, I guess?
Sure. I mean, I think it's important to remember that sustainability has three legs. I mean, we quite often, when we talk sustainability, we talk about environmental sustainability and biodiversity, and that's very important. And again, that's one of the reasons why we like eucalyptus. It grows fast, captures a lot of carbon. And you also, since it grows fast, you don't have to use so much land to produce the same amount of wood. So you can actually set aside more land for biodiversity. I mean, in Paraguay, the law says you have to set aside 0%. The FSC certification, where FSC certified, says 5%. And we are setting aside 25% because we think it's the right way to do. But we also have to remember, I mean, the social sustainability and the economic sustainability. If the people in the region doesn't benefit from what you're doing, you won't get their approval for the investment. And in our plantations, compared to the land that we're using, I mean, the land that use a degraded cattle ranching land. And we create about 15 times the job opportunities on the same land. We always hire locally, and we make sure that everyone is paid what we call minimum sustainable living wage, which is usually higher than the minimum wage of the country. And we also make sure they have a safe working place and that they're paid in time and also get SSO. So we can definitely see that the villages around where we are investing, that the livelihoods are improving for the communities around there. And then lastly, we cannot forget the economic sustainability also of the project, because you need to get returns in order to have investors investing in the project, and returns both to the regional returns to the communities and the country as a whole, but also the investors. And then it's a true sustainable project.
And I can say that that last part, the show the economic impact in the local community, is something that we as Astarte also was impressed from the beginning, because investing in emerging markets, investing in Paraguay, you can really see how you're boosting economic activity and bringing income really in an area that is very much important. So that was also a big part. On the biodiversity specifically, I would like to mention, because really we wanted this panel to be about insights from LPs into this process, right, coming into it. And I would like to mention that one of our investors is a leader in environmental services, is a UK pension fund. And they specifically commissioned a separate research on biodiversity, checking exactly can really a monoculture effectively, right? Can really a eucalyptus plantation have not adverse or even positive, I guess, impact on biodiversity? And the report showed that eucalyptus in places like ours, if planted properly, therefore, and it can actually have a positive impact on soil conditions. And that's something that we really think it's missed often or not necessarily appreciated. So then maybe if you can touch slightly, even a little bit more, is there any adverse, anything else to add or adverse? How do you work with local communities, right, Guarani? And is there any adverse effect there?
I saw we got some questions on the biodiversity in the question panel. And I'll just touch, since we're talking about that a bit, but with the biodiversity, I mean, it's really important on what level you're looking at the biodiversity. Of course, if you look at the square meter in the center of our plantations, right where the eucalyptus is, well, the biodiversity is not that great. But if you look at the landscape level, where you see the mosaic planting that we have done together with the corridors and the buffer zones and where we enhance the value. So always compared to what is there when we start, we always try to conserve and enhance the biodiversity. And then for the local communities, it's a very important question of the indigenous people in the country. There are Guarani indigenous people in Paraguay. And it's a very interesting question, because today we are avoiding planting close to the indigenous communities. And we have a certain buffer zone that we use to make sure that we don't impact these communities in any way. But we also have to remember that since we're not planting close to them, it means also that if they're going to reap the benefits from our project, they actually have to move and come closer to our plantations. I don't know if it's me or you that froze now, Teresa. I hope you can still hear me. And also as an example, I mean, our CEO of the project in Paraguay, he's actually Guarani himself. So we have a local connection to him as well. Okay, so as Teresa will also not be, that was at least I'm still here. So anyway, what we see, I mean, we believe that the forest industry is probably one of the most sustainable, if you look at all three aspects of investment. And the question we have discussed before with many of our investors is why isn't everyone doing it if it's such a win-win for everyone? And we think the key is to find the right place, the right location. I mean, we mentioned it before that we think that Paraguay is great for a forest industry investment, but it's not for every country and it's not for every place. I mean, you need to find where you have the biological growth rate, as we mentioned. You need to find a place where there is degraded land. Again, we don't think you should establish plantations where there are already native forest or native grasslands or anything like that. There has to be land that has been used and has been degraded. And we also believe that it should be a low population density to make sure we don't compete with agricultural land and food security in that country. Now I have a little bit of a problem because now I was going to plan to hand over some questions to Teresa, and she's not here. We'll see if she comes back. And while we're waiting, we can see, can answer some questions. Oh, now Teresa's coming back. That's good. Welcome back, Teresa. I'm glad it's not only me having IT problems today.
Yes, so really apologies for that. Very embarrassing. Probably not the best time, but hopefully I made it back.
Yes, you made it back right when I was going to turn it to you. So you're perfect timing.
All right, fantastic. So, and again, apologies for everything. One question we have from the audience is if Paraguay is the, you know, the best place, what is the third one? And one question we typically get is that if this is such a great story and a win-win, right? What are we doing also? Did you cover that already, Martin?
I actually covered that one while you were gone.
Okay, fantastic. So,
all right, so, perfect. No, but also, I mean, now I've been talking a bit about why we as foresters and forest industry actors are liking Paraguay so much. But I would like to know a little bit from your side. I mean, you have now invested into the project, and from your perspective as an investor, why you choose to invest in a project in an emerging market like Paraguay and not doing it in the US or Sweden or UK?
And that, quite frankly, is a very common discussion we have with many other LPs, right? As they approach forestry, and clearly more developed, more mature markets are Northern Hemisphere, like US and UK, as you mentioned. For us, our main response and reason for us investing in Paraguay and for other investors to keep in mind as they come in this sector is it's very important to set clear investment targets for your mandate, your strategy and mandate, because different jurisdictions have very different impact effectively, correct, or end results. If your target is climate change, you really need to follow where you can have the maximum impact for your capital, correct? You need to see where your capital can have the most impact, not only environmentally, but again, as you heard, socially. And reality is US, UK, the more developed countries have less potential in that front. It's typically more expensive land, so by default, less area that you can develop. It's less development, it's more preservation of existing assets. And of course, there is less social impact that you can have. In emerging markets, let's not forget, really, these are areas that natural capital, like forests, is one of their few assets that can help them out of poverty, really, or increase their average income. So for us, emerging markets is really key if your mandate is impact and climate change. And that's what we would like people to keep in mind, or investors as they go and they make their agendas and mandates to make sure they appreciate the differences.
Like you mentioned, this about the social impact. I mean, for me personally, this is what gets me going when we're working with this project. I mean, if we would have done a project like this in the US or the UK, it would not have been as interesting. I mean, it's such a reward to be able to see the development you actually are able to do in these communities where we establish our investments. So
exactly.
I fully agree.
It's really impressive. It's really impressive. Mm. And this is coming from us as a startup who, again, traditionally, or our main focus is not emerging markets, right? But we really went there because we could see that this is where you can really maximize your impact if you really want to invest in new forestry assets. And actually, I was in a local authority pension fund conference for climate change yesterday in the UK. And one of the managers there was showing statistics that it's interesting how today, even though we know that the majority of capital for nature-based solutions should be going towards emerging markets, only 20%. Hmm. It's going there. It's still 80% of the capital is still focused, invested primarily in developed markets. And we need to really address that, right? Yes.
And that's also why I think where I think the forestry industry has the great impact, because we are creating jobs in rural areas. They don't have to move into the cities. They can still stay where they already live with their families, and they get job opportunities there. So anyway, I mean, now we've been selling Paraguay quite a lot here for a while. So if Paraguay now is so great as we say, why haven't we heard of it? I mean, this is quite a common question that we get, that they think it's a part in Uruguay or So why haven't we heard of Paraguay before?
And it's funny because reality is this is the same journey we went through and we go through with most LPs, quite frankly. Very few people have heard Paraguay. Very few people have heard the name Asunción, which is the capital of Paraguay, right? So it's interesting. What is really interesting is if you actually start looking into Paraguay, it's impressive how much we don't know about it, even though it is one of the most stable economies in Latin America. It has very stable politically. It's two parties, really stayed in power for a very long time. Pretty clear tax environment, very investor friendly. You don't have issues with foreign ownership like in other Latin America countries. And it's a lot of the transactions. I mean, in our project, quite frankly, both off-take agreements, land acquisitions are US dollar denominated. So again, you don't even have the FX exposure or risk to a big extent. Pretty clear land titles. So why have we not heard about it before? I think the reality is because it's a small landlocked country, very near giants like Uruguay, who are on the ocean and naturally, in many ways, has been maybe attracting, being the first frontier for forestry investment. So Brazil, Uruguay now have very established, I would say, expertise or forestry industry. At the same time, obviously, it's becoming increasingly more mature. So prices are inflating, the best locations are taken. So what we are seeing is that, yes, Paraguay actually has been out of the radar, below the radar for most people so far, but it is really attracting attention. I think even on this conference, we have there's another session touching on Paraguay. And we know also from the industry that the next expansions are looking for Paraguay. And that's where we think it's a great advantage to have an operational base now for 10 years, because what you've done in the previous years, right? You have gone through extensive R&D, you have built out a very large base, and we feel that that's a clear advantage again. But I'm pretty sure that a lot of people will know Paraguay soon.
Pretty sure, I agree. But I think that's the perfect sentence to end this interview together with you, Teresa, because we have got a lot of interesting questions I've seen. So I think we'll leave the last 4 minutes here, or 3 minutes now, for some questions. And a lot of them are forestry related, so I guess I'll start to take some from the beginning here. So one question is why we have chosen eucalyptus again. Is it also because of the market demand? And I said yes, it's definitely because there is a demand for eucalyptus, and it's also it's a known tree, and you know the products. I mean, we usually try to keep it very simple. Don't try to, I mean, being in an emerging market has its challenges, trying to reinvent the wheel on top of that just to make it even more complex. So we try to keep it simple with known technology as much as we can.
Question that we can take is on additionality, I guess, right, Martin?
Yes.
Because this is a very common discussion as well. Is there really an argument for additionality given that the project has significant financial return?
Yeah, I would argue that it definitely is. I mean, we have been in Paraguay from 2013. There's definitely been its challenges. We are one of the pioneers. There's, when you do a barrier analysis, you can definitely see that there are hurdles in order to do this investment. We are one of the first movers in the country of doing it at this scale. So there's definitely, and also, I mean, before Astarte came into the picture, we have having trouble to raise capital for it because people didn't know Paraguay. And so we can also show that you need to have a fairly high return in order to get investment like this into a country like Paraguay. So that's why we think it's important that you combine both the carbon credits and also a viable return. But without the carbon credits, I don't think this project would have happened.
And on that, I would like also to make the point that additionality doesn't require negative returns, correct? Mm. It's just that you need to prove that that carbon credits bring or help significant, or without the carbon credits, I guess, there would be actually difficulty in attracting financing, correct? And funding the project, which is quite true. And I can also say from our side, we have been looking into, you know, this project for a couple of years, and the recent dynamic of the carbon credit market has changed entirely the landscape, right, of investor appetite investing in such projects. So then I guess another question for you is probably on agroforestry.
Yes, sure. And I will try to combine a couple of the questions that I see. I mean, yes, we have tried agroforestry. And there's another question about, have you looked at other countries? We have a similar project, a sister project in Laos, where we are doing agroforestry. We plant rice together with the trees. So we have tried it. We come back to this with location. I mean, there is no one solution fits all. You have to apply a plantation method that fits the country. And in Paraguay, since it's mainly grazing land that we've been on, we believe that it's better to have the type of mosaic plantations that we have without agroforestry. We are, however, inviting cattle ranchers to continue to have their cattle grazing in our plantations.
Yeah. I think we need to wrap up. Hopefully that was a good discussion for everyone. Apologies for the technical issue. There is a lot more. There are a lot more discussions and questions too. So very happy to connect privately with whoever is interested, and Martin as well. So
for sure.
Thank you very much.
Send me an email. Thank you so much.
Thank you.